All right. So I work as Devo compliant. What we do is that we have a money laundering product. We basically catch online money laundering over the internet. We can identify whether illegal websites selling drugs or other kinds of illegal stuff, whatever you can think of, go wild. Is laundering the money through legitimate websites like flower shops, stuff like that. And we work with credit card companies, they're our clients, and we sell them. We actually have a whole different lecture about how we set up during the lecture a website, two websites, one illegal and one legal, and funnel money through the illegal website through the legal one. And at the end of the lecture, you can even see the credit card statement showing the illegal transaction. We use online data as our mainly source of data, mainly crawling data and all kind of other databases as well. And over the years, we built quite a few solutions. They're all machine learning based, and we learned quite a lot. We learned about the proper way of doing stuff, and mainly about what's not the proper way of doing stuff, and suffered a lot over it. And if I would have heard this lecture about 4 years ago, it would probably save me about two. So here we go. In this lecture, we're going to talk about basically two case studies. One is a multi-class classifier. Talk about what was the problem exactly and what stuff we encountered that we shouldn't do, and also what's the proper way of doing it. Other problem is graph traversal. Before that, I'm going to do very quick recap about what a machine learning project is, so we'll be on the same baseline. And here we go. Okay, so machine learning projects. Sometimes when you think about machine learning project, you probably imagine that you get some kind of a data set, like in Kaggle competitions or Academy, and you have to do your best on that data set, find the best scoring model, and that's about it. So in the industry world, it's more sophisticated. I guess that probably most of you are aware of it as being software developers. You have to have business requirements. You often have to define your own solution for stuff. You have to do the proper deployment, make sure it works over time. So a lot of the difficulties come from those areas, not exactly from the model building stage. So you start with a problem definition. This usually comes from the business side. And they say what exactly is the problem, what they have to do, what we need as a solution, like what's the giveaway. And they set clear success criteria. For one project, it can be high score of accuracy. Another one can be recall or precision. And this is very similar to other software development projects, only we have a black box in the middle. Next stage, collecting data. So, not sure if I said, but machine learning is the art of making computers learn from examples. So you don't explicitly program them to do something, you tell them, okay, here are a bunch of examples, this is the problem, this is how you should behave, and the computer figures it out by itself how to do it. So what we need is a set of examples. So let's say that we want to solve a problem of phishing emails. We want to identify whether an email message is legitimate or not, whether it contains any kind of phishing or not. So we collect examples. In this case, examples will be email messages. Very good. And we have to tag them, say which kind of what email message is a phishing one and what a legitimate message is. Afterwards, you split your data into two sets, train and test. You train your model on the train set and use the test set to see how good it is and also to choose the highest scoring one. Okay, model building. Here, you usually play with your data. You start with playing with your data, try to do some kind of process that you call feature engineering or feature extraction. In our previous examples, email messages, you take the email message and you can, for example, extract keywords or keywords count out of it and say, okay, if I got those keywords, I can build a model on top of it and figure out the way to do it later on. You test out different algorithms. You usually base that step on intuition. So we have all kind of algorithm for certain problems like NLP or maybe regression. You choose the right one. You test out which is the highest scoring one, and you also do some kind of hyperparameter optimization. Try to find the best parameters for that model. Next step, deployment, as you love. You pack it as an API or you deploy it as a package and you just serve it as a product. You have to do some stress tests to see that you can handle loads and see how fast it works. You have to create monitoring, make sure it works over time. And last thing not written here is that you have to make sure that it keeps its accuracy over time. Some data sets tends to change over time. Let's say in our world, money laundering, criminals involved over time become more sophisticated and our models have to be updated all the time. All right, case study number one. So we got a problem definition from the business side. We had to have a classifier. In our case, it was a website classifier, try to classify a website into kind of line of business categories. Think about thousands of categories or hundreds of categories that are out there, sport, news, whatever you can think about. And we have to say for each website on the internet, what's the correct classification or the correct category or correct class, as you can see here. For data collection, we used manual tagging, meaning that we had to hire a few people to collect data. It took us a few months. At the end of this process, we had a fairly good data set. And for the first solution, we choose naive bias as the algorithm to go. We train the best model that we can achieve and integrate it with an API. It all worked fairly well. We had a great accuracy, great recall, meaning that we didn't miss that much. And it was perfect for the stage that we were at. It enables growth, it kept us running for about, let's say, a year. But the problem started when the business definition evolved a little. So this model had a fairly low precision, which was okay at the beginning, but when the business definition evolved, you can see here in the bold, we also needed to have high precision as well. We used the same dataset, so no need to tag new data for that problem. But we wanted to be a little more sophisticated, so we said, okay, our old solution was naive bias, worked pretty well. Let's add another classifier on top of it, which will lower the or make the precision better. And we used random forest for that. You can see the architecture right here. So we had the data on the left, same data as before. Model number one and model number two was based on model number one's output. What we hoped is that the model number two, random forest, will pick up where model number one left, and at the end of the day, we'll have a fairly good solution. Okay, that's don't number one. Don't put models in vertical lines. I have to say that at the beginning, this solution worked pretty well. We got the accuracy we needed, we had the same recall as before, and we managed to boost up the precision, met the business need, and it was good to go, integrated it, and shipped it to customers. Problem began when we tried to retrain the model or add new sets of categories, basically maintain it over time. What you usually don't do in academy or Kaggle competitions. What happened is that when we tried to update model number one, basically we created a domino effect that invalidated model number two and afterwards. So model number two became irrelevant as well, also the predictions, and the cost of adding a new category increased from just a few days in the first solution or in the data set that we collected to over 3 weeks of manipulations of models, of data, stuff like that. So it became exponentially grow, and about a year ago, it was too much and we decided to introduce a new solution. And that's about that. So what can you do to solve this or at least to avoid it? Well, first solution, don't avoid it, but Sometimes it's inevitable, you can't avoid it, but you can introduce some kind of system which is called end-to-end learning, which basically just packs two, those two models together, treat them as a single model where you have the same entrance points as before, the same data that you used, and the same output as before, and basically with a push of a button you can train both models. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with, but probably all heard about neural networks. Yeah, some kind of algorithm, all right. So a neural network is a perfect example for it, because you have a lot of layers. You can treat each layer or each neuron as a different model. And with a push of a button, you feed forward all the data and then calculate what has to be changed. Basically, training a lot of simple models together to create a powerful one. So this is solution number one. Don't use it unless you have to, but if you do use it, make sure with a push of a button you can train both models. Solution number two, which is better in my opinion, that's the architecture that we chose, is to create two parallel tracks of solutions. Track number one will cover some categories with high precision and everything. Track number two will cover a different aspect of the problem. And on top of that, on the right side, you introduce a business layer. The business layer should take all the results from before, which is not raw data. All those tracks, all those models have to meet very high quality criteria. They have to have the same false positive, false negative, precision recall that you want to introduce in the end. But the business layer can choose, okay, so I got categories one and two, let's say drugs, from the top lane, and I also got, let's say, a website that you can pay with, something else from the bottom lane, and now I have to make a business decision, not a model decision, in order to create a proper output for the product. So that's about that. What we also did is to make it even more sustainable and introduce a new architecture for the entire company's data problem. We call it DAME. We actually built the acronym before we chose the name, before we selected the acronym, so just to treat it as a DAME, DAME of data. And what you can see here, let's start from the left, in our world is the data layer. Let's say for that example, crawling data. So you call the entire internet and you have a representation of a website on the left. And what you do is you create a second layer of apps. They all share the same interface, meaning they have the same entrance and output. And each one solves a different kind of a computation task or something like that. So the first one in our example can be a classifier, classifies websites, same architecture as we saw before. Second one can be entity extraction, let's say extract names, addresses, phone numbers, stuff like that. And go on, you can have infinite number of apps, and each app puts its output on the same database. Let's say that you create a special column, JSON type, where you can just put the output of the app before, and you store everything on that database. We can also call it a data lake. I know that it's not the proper way of using it, but let's say it is. So this database basically holds, you can have tens of applications, aggregated data over the internet. For example, it can have both the classification and countries. What you can do is you can create a business app afterward to just query the database, say, okay, I want all the websites with classifications of a flower shop and who's based in Berlin. And that's the solution that I'm going to give, all flower shops in Berlin. A different application can be, I want all the construction works, which has a special phone number and doesn't have any kind of website in its ecosystem that sells something else. Whatever you want, you can come up with, and with just a few, I want to say minutes or let's say days of work, you can create a solution end to end based on the aggregation that you already done. That's advantage number one. Advantage number two, you can put whatever you want. You can just add another column in that database, which holds the version number of that model. And you can say, okay, so models that starting with a zero are in beta stage and don't want to use them afterwards, but everything that is 1 point something is in production grade and I can use it. So that says something about the quality criteria. And I'm as a developer or as a data scientist, I can introduce applications in beta stage, actually understand what's the impact on the entire world, create a data set that I need for future use, and I can use the production company, the company's production environment for doing so, enjoying all the production resources, but without compromising anything in the way. So, something like that. All right. Problem number two, graph traversal. So I already said that we have crawlers that run all over the internet and they pull everything that you can think about. So let's say hyperlinks, IP addresses, email addresses that appears in the same website. We put everything in one massive graph. It has something like 7 billion nodes and a few times more edges. And the problem at hand is that we had to find a way to find business affiliation links between two entities. Let's say that I'm a company, flower shop, there for you, for example. They want to find all the business affiliations. Let's say that there for you has another sister company abroad, there for you US, something like that. I want to be able to use that graph to find that affiliation. So you can try to think about how we can use it in the transaction laundering business or the money laundering business. It's a fairly basic assumption that we have to use. And the business definition for that problem was that we had to have low number of results. Every company can have only very limited amounts of sister companies or same business affiliation, can't have hundreds of them. We had to have high precision, meaning what we said was a business affiliation had to be true, and fairly high recall, saying the coverage for the entire world should be fairly good. You give me a company, whatever company you want, different languages, different countries, and I have to give you an answer for it. We didn't have any data, because we couldn't find any data set of business affiliations, so what we try to do is to create an algorithm, but not in the machine learning kind of way, just smart algorithm. Think about BFS, DFS, all kinds of graph traversal algorithms, only with our logic behind it. And deployment was within an API. By doing that, we accidentally introduced a problem. I already said before that we didn't have any tag data. So when we wanted to test our solution, what we could have done is just select a bunch of companies, businesses, run them through our algorithm, get the results, and then try to do some kind of analysis over it. See if it makes sense, see if it actually the right, is it the right prediction? Are those companies actually associated? And we had to not create, but use one of our data analysis team for the analysis of that algorithm, or at least every version of that algorithm. Accidentally created a lot of manual work. It took about a few days to analyze every kind of version, every version of the algorithm. The iterations took, I think, more than a month before we gave up. And the results were also non-conclusive. So in the graph in the right side, you can see two models. One has a very high recall, but fairly low precision. The other one has a little smaller recall, but is very good in the precision. Now, which model is better? I'm not sure. And neither was were our business guys, and we had to reinvent our entire solution each time, saying, okay, so we're gaining that much kind of precision, but we lose on the number of results, stuff like that, creating a loop. So what's the right way of solving it? Okay. Use DDD, data-driven development. I also checked, that's not the right acronym, but in the data world, it does work. What it basically means is don't ever try to develop a data-oriented product without having a test set in the end. If you do it like that, create the test set before you start developing, you will be able to use very fast iterations of, you'll be able to test your solution very quickly. you'll get all the measurements that you need right with the click of a button, and then you can choose what's the best algorithm. And you can also use automatic algorithms for parameter tuning, like Bayesian optimization. I'm going to touch about it in a second. Another thing which is very important, we talked about before, about the model choosing, which model was better. One very important thing to do is to create one single function for evaluation. It can be as complex as you want, it can have a lot of inputs, put it as much as you want, but it should return just a single scalar value, where higher is better or lower is better, whatever you find. For example, the F1 function, which is a combination of recall and precision, it has to be very business oriented. Everyone has to agree, okay, so if this model is higher, then we are going to use it. No change of heart afterwards. But once you have that, you can actually do iterations in a matter of minutes. And this is an example of how you do iterations. This is Bayesian optimization that we talked about before. Very complex name for a very simple task. What that algorithm does is you give him a function. That function can have whatever you want in the backside. It can do complex computation. It can be even an API for a cluster of manual labors in India. It doesn't matter as long as it returns a scalar. And that algorithm finds you the best set of hyperparameters or what kind of model you should use in order to solve your problem the best way. This is how we use it. Read the tutorial. It's really 5 minutes worth of work. We ended up using that. We also took about a month to tag a proper test set before we did that. And that whole process boosted our performance in about 30%, took us to the high 80s of accuracy and precision, and worked fairly good. And for future development, this is also revolutionary because cycles will take only a couple of minutes. We'll have to update our tag data set, but other than that, push of a button, you have a new algorithm, you can stress test it, do whatever you want, and deployment should take no more than a few minutes. You can read about that or some other do and don'ts in our blog post just published today. We are also going to make it a few series. This is what we covered right here is part 1 and 2, also part 3 is coming, and that's about it. Thank you.